You didn't just show up at church this morning. I mean, you didn't wake up this morning and go, I don't know. What do you think? I don't know. I mean, do you want to stay the whole time? Do you want to, I don't know. What about you? I'm not sure. Let's just go get a cup of coffee. We'll sort it out on the way. No. If you're sitting right here, you are a part of the grandest movement of God in all of history. That's really what you are. You've been chosen by God. And what's God doing? He's making himself known. That's what he's doing. And he's using you to blanket this earth and covering it with his glory. Well, good morning, church. It's good to see you here this morning. Today, we have a number of special worshipers with us today. We have some of our little guys who are now big enough for big church. So, where are our big enough for big church kids? Y'all stand up. Y'all stand up. Let me wave at y'all. Come on. There they go. Look at them. Awesome. Wow. They're everywhere. Way to go in the balcony. Awesome. And you know what? We are glad to have y'all in worship. And aren't we, church? Aren't we glad to have these young families and these little guys that are joining us today? And we're looking forward to them being a part of our time together. And speaking of together, sounds like a great theme for a church, don't y'all think? That is our theme for 2024, and actually it's our theme for August of 2024, together. And you know, we've put together and designed this new devotional guide for you. I hope you've gotten one of these. If you're new to our church today, they're in all of our welcome areas. They're available online, but each week we have a focal passage together in word that the entire church is reading. We have also the application of that together in deed that's suggested here in this worship guide or in this devotional guide. But also, we're just, as well as the focal passage every week, I'm asking you just to read through the entire letter to Ephesians each week, just to be familiar with what God is saying to us in Ephesians. So with that said, today the message is entitled Together in Praise and Prayer. Our text is found on page 1 of Ephesians. So if you have your copy of the New Testament, look at that with me. And we're going to begin reading in verse 3 of Ephesians 1. And I want us to go back and think about what it was like to these early believers who received these letters originally. We talked a little bit about that last week. So to imagine, remember this letter, like a number of Paul's letters, this one in particular, would have been passed around to various churches. This one for sure was a circular letter. And so just imagine that you were a part of a local church in that first century. It's AD 60. Paul is in prison in Rome, and he's writing these notes. And so you're in a church in Ephesus. What that meant was there were about 5 or 6 or 7 of you gathered in someone's apartment, their home. You might be in a little bit larger group. There might be 15 or so of you. You might be in a room behind someone's shop, and or you might have been somewhere else. You might have been in Miletus or in Laodicea or in Colossae. This letter was to make its way through all those little churches. And you're hearing a message from the Apostle Paul. It's being delivered by Tychicus. He is the person who brought this letter, who read it to the church. It's interesting, yesterday, this weekend, I did a deacon's retreat for Pioneer Drive Baptist Church in Abilene. And the pastor was taking me on a tour of their buildings, and one of their Sunday school classes was known as the Tychicus class. And I thought, what a great name for a Sunday school class, because Tychicus was a teacher. He was someone who took these teachings from Paul and explained them to these churches. So what we're going to do today is look at Ephesians 1, verses 3 through 23, but we're going to start with verses 3 through 14. Now, when Paul was writing letters in the New Testament, in the New Testament era that would become the New Testament, he had all kind of reasons for writing, and his letters are usually marked. The style of the letter fits the occasion. So, for example, if you read 1 and 2 Corinthians, you hear the tone of that letter where Paul seems to be saying, you're saying this, but I'm going to say this. Or now, concerning what you wrote about, here's my answer. Ephesians is not like that. Ephesians isn't filled with these short, pithy sayings. Ephesians is much more dense, and the sentences are much more complex. So, for example, you know, Paul wrote in Greek. So, when you study this in the Greek text, verses 3 through 14 is one sentence in Greek. So, it's very complex, theologically dense, grammatically challenging. And so the way we've tried to put that into a language or in our common vernacular, you'll notice we have to break it up into numerous sentences just for it to make sense to us, because English grammar and Greek grammar are so different. So this is a good, faithful translation of what Paul had to say in this very complex sentence. So let's look at it. Verse 3 of Ephesians 1. Paul says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who's blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Now remember, these are just small gatherings of people, okay? And they're receiving a message that you've received, heavenly messages, heavenly blessings, if you will. Verse 4, for he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he's freely given us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times reached their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we who were the first to put our hope in Christ might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who's a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance unto the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. Now, this morning, what I want to invite us to do is to go back in time and imagine ourselves as being a part of one of those small New Testament gatherings of believers. Without the 2,000 years of church history, without all of the theological discussions and conversations that have surrounded all of these texts, where different theologians of every era have been answering different questions, because that's what's happened throughout history. When you study theology, in the history of theology, theologians are dealing with different questions, and many times that influences how they provide the answers. Let's just go back in time like we're a part of that first century. So here's the question. What is God doing? That's where I want us to start. Well, the answer to that question is contextualized by determining what God has already done. And that is a Jewish method of interpretation. So one of the things that the people in Paul's day were wondering is, what is God doing? If you were a Jew in the first century, you wondered, what is God doing? Why is he allowing these Romans to overrun us and rule over us? And why are the Romans allowed so much authority and so much power? And why is there all this pagan ideology that's infiltrated everything around us? If you were a pagan, you wondered, which God is real? What does it even mean to know God? How can I even know that this is the real God? And what do the gods expect of me? So the question about what is God is doing is an ancient question. People are asking that question today. There are people who are wondering right now, what is God doing? And I get it. We look at our world, and it's almost like you wake up every day and there is a new crisis. Is that how y'all feel? It's just every day you open whatever device you use to read the news and whatever source you use, and there's war and violence and division, and across our society there's polarization and anger and injustice. And if you're not careful, it might seem to you that it's just unhinged, that this whatever this is just spiraling out of control. And what is God doing with all of this is happening around us? But here's what I want to encourage you today in this truth as Christians. I want to make sure you and I know God is sovereign and he is at work. He's always been at work. He's at work right now. He breaks into history. That's what God does. That's what he did in this era. In Paul's day, God broke into history through his Messiah. And now through Messiah's people, that would be us, the church, God has uniquely gifted the people of the Messiah. We've been uniquely positioned by him, empowered by him to fulfill his purpose in our world. So that's really where I want us to begin today. So if you ask the question, what is God doing? And you say, well, what has he done? Let's talk about that. What does the Bible teach us about what God has done? Well, Ephesians 1, verses 3 through 14 reveals what God's done. Paul lays it out in this long sentence. He's blessed, he's chosen, he's destined, he's freely given, he's lavished, he's made known. That's what this text says in this long sentence. So let's just look at it. If you have your Bibles still open, what has God done? Well, look at verse 3. He's blessed us. You see, Paul was very familiar with the scripture. Here's one of the challenges you and I face today in American Christianity, if I can say it politely. We just don't know our Bibles. We just don't. We don't know our Bibles well enough. Our minds are not saturated with biblical stories and biblical truth. We're so propositionally driven, and we're so culturally colored, if you will, and we're so issue-directed. It's hard for us to just know what the Bible teaches. Paul knew his Bible, and he knows that the God of the Bible is the God who blesses. It's just God's nature to bless. How many times do you think Paul has read those stories about how God blessed Abraham and God blessed Isaac and God blessed his people? And you read about the blessings of God over and over and over in what you and I would call the Old Testament. And now Paul realizes he's living at a moment in time where God has chosen for heaven and earth now to come together in a unique way in the Messiah. And what does he refer to that as? It's a blessing. God's blessed us in our day, Paul is saying. He has also chosen us. That's what he says. You've been chosen. Now remember, let's imagine there's five or six of us sitting in a little house in Ephesus, and we got this letter from Paul, and Tychicus said, let's read this together. You're chosen. And we look at each other and go, us? We're chosen? By who? By God. Wow. You know, we're not here accidentally. We've been chosen by God. Not only that, he says you've been destined. The NIV translates it predestined. Now that freaks a lot of people out. There's no need to be freaked out by it. That word destined, it means to draw a boundary around. It means that God has a plan for his people. And it's not something that has just happened. It's not something that's willy-nilly. It's not something that is just spinning out of control and all of a sudden God's up in heaven scratching his head wondering, what in the world am I going to do with all of this stuff? Okay, maybe I've got an idea. No, God had a plan. God understood full well what was going to take place in his creation. And so he is destined that his people are going to be his children, he says. Look at verse 5. He's destined us to be his children. And notice the focus is on Jesus. Through Jesus Christ, and it'll be in accordance to his pleasure and his will. So he has destined us, chosen us, blessed us. Notice what else? He's freely given us. Look at verse 6. He has freely given us his grace. We've not earned it. It's not something that you and I were able to perform at a certain level and God said, I think I'll grace them a little bit. No, God has just chosen to do it. And notice when God does something, notice what this text says. He doesn't, look at verse 8. He doesn't just pour out a little bit of grace. He lavished it on us. He's extravagant in his giving. So God has saturated us. He has drenched us. He has covered us fully and then some with his grace. But then here may be the kicker. This is the one that's going to be the most hard for these people to believe, maybe even for us to believe. If you look at verse 9, And he's revealed to us, he's made known to us the mystery, he says. He's made known to us the mystery of his will, which he's purposed in Christ. He has revealed it to us. Once again, can you imagine if you're in that small group of believers and you're hearing this letter from Paul, and Paul says, you know what God has done? He's revealed himself to you. He's made himself known to you. In other words, you're not just here accidentally. You're a part of something that God is right in the middle of. And the church now is going to be the vehicle through whom God is going to work. So therefore, if that's true, then we're going to have to be informed. God's going to have to reveal some things to us. We're going to have to know him. We're going to have, look what it says in verse 8. He's lavished us. Then it says, with all wisdom and knowledge. What is God giving to the church? He's giving to the church what he made available and he revealed in Jesus. Wisdom and knowledge, because the church is so important. You see, the church has got to be able to discern truth. The church has got to be able to hear the voice of God. The church has got to be able to know the wisdom of God. The church has to have a level of understanding. We're not out here just doing our own thing. That's not what the church does. We're not just doing what we want to do and kind of collecting our gathering up all of our collective genius and just trying to figure out what to do next. That's not who the church is. The church is not just willy-nilly just meandering its way through history on its own. No. The church has received the wisdom and the understanding of God. What Paul is trying to do is elevate your understanding and everybody's understanding of who the church is. We're here to accomplish the will of God in Christ Jesus. That's what we're here to do. And the only way to do that is to know the will of God in Christ Jesus. And the only way for that to happen is for God to reveal the will of God in Christ Jesus. And that's exactly what he says he's doing. That's what he's done. That's what he's now doing. So what is God doing? Let me tell you what God is doing right now, 2024. He's at work through the people of God. He's at work through the church in ways that you and I might not even imagine, that we may not even stop and realize. But that's what's happening. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about that. Let me just remind you, Paul is a first century Jewish theologian. He can't help himself. That's the lens through which he's going to view everything. And so if you know anything about Judaism, you know that when it came time to praise God, what that meant was the Jewish tradition of praising God is practiced by recounting how God has worked in the past with an expectation of how he may work in the future. So in the synagogues in the first century, when the Jews gathered to worship, one of the things they did was they praised God. Well, how do you praise God? You praise God by recounting all that God has done. You tell these stories about God's victory, about God's power, about God's presence. You saturate, in other words, your mind with how God has worked in history. Now, once again, this is one of the challenges that we face in the contemporary church. We just don't know our Bibles well enough. And so many of these stories, we don't know them. We haven't taken the time to try to understand, why did God do that the way he did it? And what did God actually do? And because we're so preoccupied and distracted by so many other things, we're not saturated with those stories. Paul was. And Paul was leading Jews who had become Christians to learn about the hand of God at work through history and now connect it to where they are today. He was teaching the Gentiles who didn't have that heritage about all that God has done in the past so that they could be prepared for what God was doing right now and on into the future. So you celebrate and praise God by recounting what God has done. So Paul does that in this very text. What does Paul do in this text we just read? Well, he uses imagery that, again, if you're not paying attention, you will miss. The imagery underneath Ephesians 1, 3 through 14 is the Passover. This passage is laden with imagery from the Passover and the Exodus. That's what's underneath this story. You say, well, preacher, how do you know that? He doesn't mention it. Yes, he does. He does it with the language that he uses and the imagery that he uses and the portrait that he paints. I want you to think about the story of the Exodus. It's the story, creation, Exodus, and exile. These are the stories of the Old Testament. So think about the Exodus. Do you remember what happened when God delivered Israel out of Egypt? And they're preparing now to go towards the promised land. Here's what God told Israel. All of you have tents to live in. Now build me a tent. And that's where I'm going to be. And this tent's a special tent. And so he gave them specific instructions on how to build it. And that tent was called the tabernacle. Once they finished that tent, God moved in. You remember that story? And when God moved in, there was glory and smoke and fire. You remember all of that? And the children of Israel, it was hard to even look at it. But it was heaven and earth came together. All of a sudden, heaven inhabits this tent. And so it became this huge pillar. There was a pillar of cloud by day. There was a pillar of fire by night. And the very presence of God was there. And every Jew in the camp knew it. And they wouldn't go anywhere until that pillar was ready to go. And you would pack up the tabernacle and God would go with them. Now the day would come when they would finally move and settle and live in the promised land. And eventually they would build another building that was stationary in Jerusalem. And that's where God met them. And that was the temple. So the Lord inhabited the temple. The glory of God descended upon it. And it represented heaven and earth coming together. And was a powerful expression of the presence of God. Paul knows that. So Paul has all that in his mind. And so Paul now says, we're living in the age of the new Exodus. Look at verse 10. He says, God now is going to bring everything, both heaven and earth, the entire cosmos, he's bringing all of it in unity in heaven and on earth in Christ. He now is that new tabernacle. Heaven and earth have merged together in Christ. Jesus will allude to that in his teachings. You know, in the Old Testament, Israel is viewed as a vine, and God plants the vine. What does Jesus say in John 15? I now am the vine, and my Father's the gardener. Jesus is saying, I'm the new Israel, if you will. He's the new tabernacle. He is now where heaven and earth have merged together. And we shouldn't miss it, because what did John say in John 1 verse 14? The Word became flesh and tabernacled among us, and we beheld his glory as of the one and only. So in other words, Paul is taking all of that and helping us understand this is who Jesus is. And then, not only that, he says, let me just make sure you understand, I'm referring to the Exodus and the Passover. Look back at this text where Paul says he has chosen us in verse 4. In verse 5, he's predestined us. But look at verse 7. He says, in him we have redemption, the NIV says. The Greek text, we've been delivered. Now, here's what's interesting about that. Paul, when he was reading his scripture, we think most New Testament Christians, most first century Jews, read the scripture in Greek, not Hebrew. And that meant they read the Septuagint. Well, if you read the Septuagint, which is the Old Testament translated into Greek, that word deliverance is the word for being rescued out of Egypt. That word is used in the Old Testament to refer to the Exodus, to God's deliverance, if you will. So Paul uses that word, and that word signals something to every Jew. Oh, the deliverance. You're talking about the Exodus. And then just to make sure that you connect it, notice what he says. We have redemption. How? In verse 7, through his blood. Well, the Passover is the story of blood. The blood put on the doorpost of each Israelite's home, so the angel of death passed over, and because of that, they were set free, delivered, and the Exodus happened. Paul says, we're living in a different era now, because Paul says, now that blood, you see, Israel wasn't forgiven for their sin at the Passover. That's not what happened. They weren't in Egypt because they were being judged for their sin. But Paul says, the new Exodus is different. We're being set free not from the tyranny of Egypt. We're being set free not from the power of Rome. We're actually being delivered from sin itself. It's much more insidious than Egypt or Rome. And the only way for us to be set free from that and delivered from that, the only way for the angel of death to pass over us, if you will, is for the blood of Jesus to be spilled on our behalf so we could be forgiven. And now the new Exodus is occurring, and God has raised up a new people of God. Are y'all still with me? So And here's the thing. We just don't know our Bible well enough, so we just read right past it. And so we've got, y'all, come on, y'all. We got to slow down and read and listen and ask for the discernment of the Spirit of God, because God wants to give us wisdom and knowledge and understanding of what he's doing. Our Messiah has come, and he's not just here to deliver Israel. He's the Savior of the whole world. That's what he's going to do. So here's the plan. What is the plan? The plan is God's great plan of redemption and rescue is going to result in the praise of his glory throughout creation. That's what Paul is talking about. Now again, I'm sitting in a room with six or seven believers there in Ephesus in the first century, and I've heard that there are a couple of other pockets of us in Ephesus, and then I've heard there's even some believers down in Mansfield that are meeting. I never met them, but I've heard they're down there. I've even heard they're as far away as Waco, that there are some Christians down there. I've even heard there's some Christians in places like College Station. Come on, y'all. I've even heard there's some in Austin. I mean, in other words, I'm sitting here in this little small group of people, and you're telling me that because of what I'm doing, because of who I am, ultimately God's glory is going to cover the whole world? That's exactly what Paul is saying. He's saying, lift your gaze, church, because here's how he's going to do it, y'all. The people of God, that's how he's going to do it. The church is to be used by God to accomplish God's plan on this earth. How's he going to do it? Look at verse 11. We've been chosen by him. We've been destined according to the plan of him who works out everything. He says, now, what's going to happen is all of us who were Jews first, verse 13, those of you who also now are included, we are God's possession now to the praise of his glory. And this is going to blanket all of creation. Verse 10, it's all actually going to be brought together in Christ himself. That means that the glory of God is going to blanket the earth. How? How's the glory of God going to blanket the earth to the praise of God's glory? Through us. Through us. The people of God are going to blanket the earth, and everywhere we go, we take the glory of God with us, and we're going to push back the forces of darkness. We're going to destroy brokenness. We're going to set captives free. We're going to help people find their way to real life. And when we do that, we're bringing God's glory to the ends of the earth. A few years ago, we were in West Africa, and we were doing a medical clinic, and with our Pastor Emmanuel. He's our pastor there. And a chief had come, and Emmanuel was telling me the story. And the chief showed Emmanuel, he was missing some toes. And Emmanuel asked him about it, and the chief said, well, we're having trouble in the village. I was having trouble, and I went to the spiritualist, or whatever they're called. Gabe and Seder are sitting right here. I don't know if witch doctor is the right way to put it, but whatever it is you call them. And that guy said, well, I need some of your toes. And so he cuts the toes off of the chief's foot to somehow placate these forces of darkness. This chief asks Emmanuel, is your God going to take more of my toes? And Emmanuel said, our God came to set you free from all of that. He came to push back those forces of darkness. He came to destroy that power of evil. He came to bring you redemption and hope and life that'll last forever. You don't have to give him that because he's given you everything. How's the church going to do it? The church is going to make its way across the world to the praise of God's glory and push back these forces of darkness and these forces of evil and deliver people in the name of Jesus, because our God is at work through his church all over the world to set people free. So, come on, y'all. You didn't just show up at church this morning. I mean, you didn't wake up this morning and go, I don't know. What do you think? I don't know. I mean, do you want to stay the whole time? Do you want to? I don't know. What about you? I'm not sure. Let's just go get a cup of coffee. We'll sort it out on the way. No! If you're sitting right here, you are a part of the grandest movement of God in all of history. That's really what you are. You've been chosen by God. And what's God doing? He's making himself known. That's what he's doing. And he's using you to blanket this earth and covering it with his glory. Let me read to you a quote from N.T. Wright. Here's what he said to us in Houston a few weeks ago. The point of it all is the display of God's eternal and now revealed plan of rescue to show creation that he is the glorious creator. The church is to be the advanced sign to the world, the new heaven and earth reality that God plans to make. The purpose of God leads to the purpose of the church. The point of the church is to be so visibly the people indwelt by the Spirit of this God of love and grace and generosity and healing and hope that people will see it and give praise to the Creator and Redeemer. That's what's really going on, y'all. And you say, well, how in the world can that be possible? I mean, there's only seven of us, remember? We're this big. Well, you know what, Paul knew that. He knew that's what they were going to be thinking. I'm convinced of that. So guess what he did? He stopped and prayed. So let's look at what he prayed. Look at verse 15. You still got your Bible open? He stopped and prayed. He said, for this reason, the fact that the church is this incredible gift, that what was given to the Messiah has now been given to us. So for this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, once I knew you were in, he says, I've not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation, knowledge, so that you may have a comfortable life, so that you may get what you want, so that everything will go your way. No, so that you may know him better. Verse 18, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he's called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power, if you're wondering, does he really have power? That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead. And he seated him in his right hand in all the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and every name that's invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body. That means he's put everything under him and his church, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. You see, Paul knew they weren't going to believe it, so he said, Lord, show them. Would you just show them? Lord, here's what they need. They need wisdom. They need knowledge. Once again, this prayer is laced with Old Testament messianic imagery. But we just don't know our Bibles. We don't ever read Psalm 110. We don't read Psalm 8. We don't read Isaiah 11. Paul did. These are all messianic passages that are woven into this very prayer. If you want to understand these prayers, then you got to understand what Paul knew about what God was doing. What do we need? We need wisdom. We need knowledge. We need to know what we're doing. If the church forgets what it's about and loses its way, heaven help us. You know what the devil does? The devil is an expert at spiritual cataracts. So here's what the devil does. He wants the church's vision to be blurred. He wants the church's vision to be cloudy. He wants to keep the church just down here in just mundane things, focused on the wrong things, accommodating culture and acting like it's okay, or just giving in everywhere they think they need to give in. Just try to be as popular as you can and let's just see what happens. Or get over here in this little enclave and just stay mad at everybody all the time. That's always worked. See, the devil, he wants us to be cloudy. You know, when I was 25 years old, I was pastoring my first church, Jimtown, Oklahoma, and we're driving up every weekend, and I could tell my vision was not what it should be. So we played this little game. We'd be driving at night, and I'd tell Cindy, I said, okay, driving on the freeway on the way home, you tell me when you can read that sign, I'll tell you when I can read it. And she'd go, got it, and we'd keep driving. And I'd finally say, I got it. So finally she'd tell me, you're gonna have to go to the doctor, you know? If you want me to keep riding with you, you're going to have to go to the doctor. I've never been to a doctor in my life. I go to the doctor. Y'all, When I got my first set of glasses, I walked out of that, what do you call it, the glasses shop, optician, whatever you call it. I'm walking around the mall going, is this the way it is for all of y'all? I'm walking up to people. Can you see that sign right there? Are you kidding me? Have you always been able to see that without glasses? That's the first time I've ever seen it. I can't believe it. I had no idea. Come on, y'all. The church has got to see clearly, because if we don't see clearly, there's no hope for the world. And what does God promise us? Paul said, I'm praying that they'll see, that the eyes of their hearts will be enlightened, that they'll have wisdom, that they'll know what to do, they'll know what they are about. I'm praying, God, give them knowledge. Don't let them be guilty of just low horizon thinking. Don't let them be pulled down and think the church is just this or just that. He is praying that the church will come to a deep and rich, full understanding of who we really are, so we'll be experts in soul work. You know, one of my favorite hardware stores in this town is, I love to go in there because you got all these guys in there who know what they're doing. Have y'all ever been somewhere and you watch somebody and you go, you don't know what you're doing? I can tell by looking at you and what you're doing. You don't know what you're doing. I love this hardware store. You can go, I went in there one time, and whatever the opposite of a handyman is, that's what I am, right, honey? I'm terrible, but I'm cheap. So I went in there one time. I had a part of my toilet in my hands, and I walk in the deal, and the guy looked at me and said, come with me, I'll show what you need. He takes me back to the plumbing area. He takes this thing off the wall, this packet, opens it, and starts throwing stuff away. You're not going to need this. This right here is just going to confuse. I ain't even bought it yet. He's saying, this right here is going to confuse you. He throws that piece. Don't even take that. Don't even take that. Don't bother taking this home. You don't need it. When you get home, do this right here. I did. You know why? Because he knows what he's doing. When people come to the church, they should meet us, and we should show them we know what we're doing. We're spiritual people. The only way for us to know what we're doing is to know him better. One of the saddest passages in the Bible is in Hosea chapter 4, where God says, I looked all over the land, and there's no knowledge of God in the land. Hosea 4, God says, I looked all over the land, and nobody knows me. How sad that the people of God don't know their God. Paul says, I'm praying that you'll have wisdom and knowledge so that you will know him better. And if you know him better, then you'll know who it is you're supposed to be. So come on, church, let's commit ourselves today to be the people of the Messiah, communicating the truth of the new Exodus to a world that needs to be set free. May it be so. Let's pray together. Father, today we want to thank you for the good news of the gospel. My goodness, our world needs it. We need it. I want to thank you that you have communicated it so powerfully to us. And today, help us as a church, Lord, to make sure that our eyes are open, that we're paying attention, and that your will is utmost on our minds and hearts. Lift our gaze today, Lord. Remove any cloudy, fuzzy vision, any low thinking, and help us to fully embrace who we are as the church to the praise of your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.